All right, thanks everyone for joining us today. So today we have the opportunity to listen to Dr. Ting share with us. She's a professor of biomedical engineering at Georgia Tech and Emory. And so she does research in motor control, but I will let her tell you more about that. So thank you, Dr. Ting. Oh, please welcome her with me.
Thank you, Nathan, for inviting me here. I've had a lot of really good discussions already, from math to rehabilitation to robots, so it's been very, very stimulating. So today I'm going to talk to you about sort of an overview of how I think about motor control, and I had a wonderful opportunity to work with Hillel Scheel on sort of putting this together. So if there's something you want that you heard today that you like, you can just go to this paper and it probably says it much better than I'm going to say it today. So so these are some of my collaborators, not all of them. So what I'm fundamentally interested in is the interactions between the nervous system and the mechanical system that produce movements. And so what I'll be talking to you about is several different ways that we do this. In my postdoctoral research, I looked at cat reactive balance control. In my current lab, we now study a similar paradigm in humans, looking at reactive balance in humans and different strategies. And then more recently, since I started as a locomotion person, and that's what everybody thinks is cool, we have started looking at more challenging walking conditions. And in fact, this is a ballet dancer from the Atlanta Ballet walking on a narrow beam. And this is a novice, let's see if I get it, probably a college student, doing the same task. Fortunately, they're all running, so you can see it. Okay. And our interest through all of this is looking at what neuromechanical interactions and what the effect of training and experience might be on the way that it's controlled. We're measuring muscle activity and kinematics, and over here we're also measuring ground reaction forces. We don't yet have this beam instrumented for forces. So when I was a grad student getting into this field, there was very much a divide between the way that neuroscientists thought about control of movement and mechanical engineers, which is what I was, thought about control of movement. So just briefly, if you were a neuroscientist, you would say, well, neural control is hard, and we're not going to think about mechanics because the brain, you think about something, it puts out a pattern, and it just sort of tells the body what to do, and it does it, right? That's sort of the way that things were. And I came from another perspective of being an engineer where I thought, well, that's silly. We have dynamics. I learned about Newton's laws, and, you know, you can have a device like this, which is a passive walker that has no muscles and no control, actually generating a very walking-like movement, right? So my thought was, well, if we just solve these equations, we'll figure out what the brain and the nervous system should be doing. And so I will say I was not right, and Andy has also changed his mind, but I was talking to Andy Ruina in his lab, and he said, Lena, mechanics is hard and control is trivial. And what he meant by that was that it's really hard for them to make this robot do this, or this passive walker do this, and that he can design any number of controllers that can stabilize it. And he said, and therefore it's not interesting. Well, this was 10 years ago. So I said, well, actually, Andy, I think that that is interesting. The fact that you can have lots of different controllers that would produce similar mechanics. And this is why if I had, and it's not just biomechanics, if I saw you and your evil doppelganger walking across the quad, I would be able to recognize your gait, and I would know which one was which. So he told me, I'm going to show you something, and it's going to change your life. So if you know Andy, that's hilarious. And he just came to Georgia Tech and said he changed his mind, so I will give him that. And he showed me a video from a computer animator, Karen Liu, who is now also at Georgia Tech, and this was her PhD thesis, where she could synthesize, using the same biomechanical model, synthesize simulated physics-based movements that express different styles of walking. So that showed me that this is a manifestation of the fact that you can control the same mechanical system the same way. So she recorded people, she got some preferred patterns of torque, and then she simulated a different motion, so carrying this thing, this weight, in different walking styles. So remember, this is not what was recorded. This is like something was extracted out of somebody walking in a sad style or happy style, and then when you simulate a different movement in the same style, it predicts that sad people hunch over and happy people swing their arms. Okay, so now this is, of course, an animation model in which there's almost nothing physiological, although they take a lot of physiological inspiration in basically pulling out preferred patterns of joint torque that are specific to each style or to each individual, and also passive mechanical properties need to be in there. And so those are two things that they pulled out of biology, and then we in turn said, oh, well, let's look at that a little bit more. And more recently, BJ Fregley has also pulled out some preferred patterns of joint torque to improve knee joint forces in a more sort of biomechanically validated musculoskeletal model when they're looking at osteoarthritis and wear patterns on the knee. So there might be something to this. Now, I've spent my entire career looking at muscle activity, lots of muscle activity, and a lot of people don't do this. Now, I look at muscle activity because it's the output of the nervous system, and it's also the input to the biomechanical system. So the electrical signals turn into force, and so we can consider it sort of the intersection point of the neural system and the mechanical system, and we have to also remember that there are sensory receptors in the muscle that feed signals back to the nervous system that are important for control. So a lot of people, so trying to infer some kind of interaction between these from EMG, from muscle activity, is not the most straightforward thing. So there are any number of people I've talked to who have recorded, done the full suite of recordings, kinematics, kinetics, and muscle activity. And the kinetics and kinematics tell a beautiful story. And they look at their muscle activity and they go, oh, we have no idea what's going on. I need to graduate. And everything goes in a drawer and it doesn't ever get published, right? So I spend all my time looking at these things. And but the reason that people do that is because it's challenging and it's not as straightforward as the mechanics. They're highly variable across people and individuals. So how can we make sense out of those types of signals? So what I'm going to talk to you about today is the idea that there are structures. So there are some neuromechanical principles of interactions that actually Hillel helped me to really articulate. And then I'll show you how we've extracted motor structure that's related to function, both in the temporal structure of muscle activity as well as in the spatial structure of muscle activity. And for this task, I focus mainly on reactive balance control because locomotion is really hard and there's a lot more circuits and I don't know what the goals are. And then I'll talk to you about in gait, since that's what everybody cares about, how we can take these things and make some inferences about what is happening in motor deficit and then with training both in impaired as well as highly skilled individuals. Okay, so first, what are these neuromechanical principles and that we dare to lay out for you? Here are five ideas that we pulled out. So the idea that there's motor abundance, that in a system like this, there are many different solutions for a particular task that you might choose, and that the structure of the muscle activity has to reflect something about the biomechanical task at hand. But on the other hand, muscles work together to produce many different actions, which makes it very difficult to make those relationships often, and that we see a lot of variability. And in fact, this is directly out of Hillel's paper of motor variability is high where the effect on function is low. And so when we see variability, we have to be careful if we're talking about this kind of variability or the fact that the task is actually changing and requiring some kind of variations in muscle activity. And as a result of this sort of complexity, the thesis that we put out there is that individuals express different styles of movement. And this may result from us being sort of sloptimal and not really optimal in what we do. So I'm first going to take you through some things we've done with just looking at a model like this, a musculoskeletal model, and trying to understand what the effects of the biomechanics are on how you might want to control that system. And so first, this is a standard open sim model of a human with, I don't know, 92 muscles or something like that. We asked a very simple question, is when you're walking, how much does biomechanics determine muscle activity? And in fact, this was a question posed by Bernstein, where he said that impulses of action cannot be determined based on the observed kinematics of movement, right? You have to take forces and integrate them a couple times and to get displacement. And so what he said, all that we could do is sort of infer this range of forces that we would need to produce a particular motion. And that's going to depend on initial conditions and things like that. So this is just straight out of Bernstein. So he hypothesized that there was some range of forces that would correlate to some measured or observed kinematic action. And typically what people do is say, instead of asking what the range is, they say, well, what's the sort of energy optimal activation pattern? I'm just going to pick one. And we wanted to know, well, how far can you deviate from that and actually still achieve the task that you observed? And this is really important in impaired populations where they might exhibit a very sort of normal walking pattern, but the muscle activity underneath it might be quite different. So yes, the simple question is, given this, how high or low can each single muscle be activated while the system can alter itself to achieve the same joint torque? Okay, so we wanted to put explicit bounds on these things, make them not just hypothetical. And for walking, this is what we found, is that for all these muscles, the upper bound is 1 almost all the time, and the lower bound is 0 almost all the time for walking. So that means that I can remove any single muscle and still have the system achieve the joint torques that I observed, right? So that's the upper and lower bounds. The yellow is usually when the muscle's active. The blue is what's usually predicted through sort of optimization methods. Okay, and then red is some experimental EMG data. So you can see that a lot of times this gets it right on, but in other cases there's activity that's not predicted by sort of an effort optimal computation that is actually there. Okay. So this is just to show you that the amount of variability is very wide, and so if we see any single muscle turning on and off, it's very difficult to say what is actually happening on a sort of a more functional level. Okay. The other thing is that, well, we just looked at one muscle at a time. That's not really a very physiological way to think about how muscles work. Some of the earlier work we did was we just took this cat hind limb model and we said, okay, what does the one sort of biceps femoris muscle do in terms of moving the toe, either accelerating it or generating a force? And it turns out that that's not really a meaningful question because it really depends on what's happening at the other joints. So if my ankle muscle is free and floppy, then I'll get a force that looks like it's going in this direction. And then as I increase the amount of ankle torque, then the force will go in the other direction. Okay, now this one's sort of weird. It's like, we see it in pedaling, where if you are trying to pedal and your ankle doesn't do anything, then you kind of get yourself into this weird position and you end up generating a force that's not very functional. So actually coordinating sort of this muscle with some sort of ankle torque is probably what's necessary to transmit the force and the power to the ground or the pedal or doing whatever task. So coordinating the multiple joints. And so we have to really consider what combinations of muscle activity actually produce the function that we would like to see. And so the same muscles here, depending on their ratios, we could generate a more backward force or a more upward force, right? And so those relationships really matter. And the other is that, well, we have N muscles, let's say, and they can be combined in 2 to the N ways, which is an explosion, you know, recursive dimensionality, huge number of ways, and we're probably not using all of those different ways. And many of them may be non-functional or less functional than others, but they're all possible. Okay, so I put in some things because I know I'll be meeting with some of you later, and sometimes it gets a little mathy, but we'll see. Why would I select one of these patterns versus another, especially if my effort-wise optimal one is unstable? So here's just a simulation. All I had is this musculoskeletal model. I asked it to produce a force isometrically. And then for some patterns, the thing goes unstable, right? I don't know if I can run that again. And here's the problem with doing postural control or isometric force is that this one didn't move, and it doesn't even look like a simulation, but it really is. So when nothing moves, then everything is great for me. So this means that the model is able to generate a consistent force and not like lose its postural configuration. Then what we can do is map the stability in terms of eigenvalues and the amount of effort in terms of how much muscle activity there is. And we show that the minimum energy solutions, which are by and large used by musculoskeletal simulations, are always unstable, and unstable by a large amount. They're quite an outlier. And so by actually increasing the amount of energy expenditure from like less than 1% of the maximum possible, I can actually get a stable solution. So I increase it to 2.7%, about 3% of the maximum possible, and I can get a system that is now stable or marginally stable. So it's likely that we're not using ultimately low energy solutions, but nearly low energy solutions. And this also fixes my musculoskeletal modeling problem, where it gets very sensitive to round-off error in the computer. All right, so because of all that variability, I would put forth the idea that that we have to learn different individual specific patterns to do that, rather than searching this very, very bumpy, complex space. And so for walking, it's also been shown that there is sort of a structure in the way different muscles are coordinated together and the way that they're activated over time. And I'll talk more about this a little bit later. But the idea is that the structure that we see in muscle activity is going to reflect a transformation from a motor goal to a motor action. And that we have trial by trial variability is not random, but actually reflects some variations in what we want to achieve. And that we'll see individual differences that reflect sort of equivalent solutions to performing the same task that may have some implications for what happens to them in a motor deficit or in rehabilitation. So just to go over those principles again, motor abundance means that there's many solutions, and we show that there are almost no just biomechanical bounds on how you could coordinate your muscles to perform a task. But that biomechanics and energetics matter. We're probably, you don't want to spend all of your energy co-contracting your muscles, but we need a little bit that might be, observed muscle activity is similar but not identical to effort optimal. And on the other hand, energy isn't everything So there are deviations from that effort optimal, and that muscles we have to consider as being multifunctional actuators that can be coordinated in many ways to produce function. And as a result, they're what I call motor accents or motor habits, where there might be slightly different ways. So I draw a parallel to speech accents, in which different people might have different accents that are characteristic to them. You can tell what country they come from. Okay, so in the next section, I'm actually going to talk about, given this sort of biomechanical understanding of the musculoskeletal system, all right, how do I think about actual data that we collect? So mostly I'm an experimentalist. I play around with models to explain my data. And so I'm going to talk about temporal motor structure for goal level control and reactive balance. And then I'll switch and talk about spatial muscle coordination structure for joint, multi-joint level control. Okay, so here is the paradigm that I showed you. People, we have people come in, or cats, not anymore, but lots of data from cats, where they stand on a platform, and then we move the platform backwards or forwards in multiple directions. So basically pull the rug out from under them, and in this case they fall forward and activate muscles on the back of the body primarily to restore balance. So what we'll see is the onset of the perturbation is this dotted line, and then after a latency of about 100 milliseconds, we see a large activation of muscles, which corresponds to a long latency response. And sort of the cortical contributions start a little bit further out here. But we have multiple muscles activated in a directionally specific manner. What we can do is move the platform in the other direction, and you'll see a different set of muscles go on. Right? So directionally specific, by 100 milliseconds, you're responding in a very task-specific manner. And then you can extend that to sort of looking down at the top of the person here. I can perturb them in all these directions around the clock face and look at the amount of activity that's evoked in this first 100 milliseconds and characterize the activity of those muscles as tuning curves. And so what we do is here, this is the perturbation direction. So if I unwrap this clock face here, and then I plot the amplitude of activity in a little time window here, you can see that some of the muscles will be active in response to a backward perturbation primarily, and some of them will be responsive to a forward perturbation, and they're all a little bit different. Okay, so this is the basic kind of task that I've spent a lot of time looking at, and then we break it into sort of a temporal component and then a spatial component. So I'm going to talk about the temporal component first. All right. Oh yeah, this is what I was supposed to, temporal, spatial. So I'm going to talk about the temporal one because I think it sits at a higher level, and then it will activate multiple muscles in this sort of feedback loop. All right, so I moved something around. Okay. So here's a simple idea, is that when I perturb the person, then we have sensory feedback telling us about the displacement, velocity, and acceleration of the center of mass. I'm going to put that forward. And that, so the positive going signals here are then encoded with certain gains. So it's just a waiting on those signals. And then they're subject to a time delay just due to transmission of the signal through the nervous system. So it's my 100 milliseconds. It's going to go in and out. And then what we did in our analysis, we just simply summed these scaled signals together and put them through a thresholding process. So this is like a motor neuron. So you might put a signal into a motor neuron, and when it crosses a threshold, I get positive signals, and then that will predict the time course of activity of a muscle. So here's our prediction, and here's an actual muscle activity, and so this we call sensory motor response model. And in this case, you can actually just take data that you measured here and fit it to there, so it's just a regression model. But we also have a way of doing it where we have an explicit biomechanical model that we actually take those signals and then generate a torque to stabilize the model. So there's two different ways that we do it. And we do it on cats and we do it on humans. Now I'm going to show you first the data that I got, the first data that I got with this kind of model with a cat. Okay, blue here is a recorded muscle activity. Red is my simulated activity, actually without using any data to track. So what we did was we asked the simple inverted pendulum on a cart to minimize the amount of deviation from vertical when we hit it, and also to minimize at the same time some degree of muscle effort. And what you'll see is that in a cat, the delay is a little shorter because they have shorter neurons. And you get a fast rise, and then we see a little bounce and a plateau, and then the muscle activity shuts off. And that corresponds with this sort of ramp and hold perturbation. Now, surprisingly, we can reproduce these detailed features of the muscle activity, and people have argued about whether this is some nonlinearity in the motor neuron, whether it's feed forward, that kind of thing. What this is showing me is that this is purely feedback muscle activity, and that I could reproduce all these features with just four numbers, one delay, and then three just scalar weights on those channels of position, velocity, and acceleration. And why were we able to do that? Part of it is because in our model, we actually put in recorded perturbation accelerations. Okay, so if any of you have controlled devices, you can put in a trajectory, and then like the acceleration might be crazy. It won't look like what you learned in calculus or physics is what it's supposed to be. And so what happens here is that if I actually look at the acceleration of the center of mass and then shift it forward, I see that the acceleration component looks like this bouncy thing. Okay, that's just because my platform was kind of not really well controlled. And so this bounce in muscle activity actually reflects sensory information that was put into the system and then came out as muscle activity. Okay, and so it's not neural processing. This is a linear model with a delay, and I can account for almost everything that's happening. So you'll see here, this is the actual acceleration of the center of mass, and then it just comes out 35 milliseconds later on the other end. I guess those two slides said the same thing. But then the red thing, again, we did it data-free. We weren't trying to fit the model. We can do it both ways. But you can find weights which will produce this predicted, right? So it's a predictive model. Now, what you can do with a cat is you can knock out its sensory receptors by, in this case, overdoses of vitamin B6 or pyridoxine. And what happens is the animals become very ataxic. And this works through sort of a metabolic mechanism where the B6 doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier, but it goes into the dorsal root ganglion and kills off the sensory neurons. So we could dose it to target just the group ones because it affects the largest neurons first, so the ones with the largest volume. So we dosed it to target group one afferents. So, and we have some histology to show that basically we're hitting things between 10 and 20 microns. But that's going to knock out muscle spindles, cutaneous afferents, and Golgi tendon organs. So the animals get ataxic, and then after a couple weeks, they're running around the lab. They look pretty normal. And we put them back on the platform. And in fact, there are people who have this too. So they present clinically normal. This is the same animal before and after pyridoxine intoxication. And you can see that qualitatively, the muscle activity has changed pretty dramatically. So we don't have this initial burst and plateau. If I look at the kinematics, so this green thing is the center of mass displacement, you won't see anything super different. You'll just see that the amplitude is more, right? So we can't look at this kinematics and infer that the muscle activity has changed so dramatically. This red thing is another optimum where we took our model and we just deprived it of acceleration information. And so this is a new optimum solution to minimize the motion of the center of mass and the effort. And since you don't have acceleration, then you have a much slower rise in muscle activity. So this is the animal sort of converging, perhaps, on that kind of a solution. There's changes daily as they improve their behavior. And so this has launched me into a current project of trying to look for acceleration coding in muscle spindles, which I think we found and other people have suggested, but maybe not shown as explicitly. Okay, so we took this model in a cat and we just made it bigger, the pendulum bigger, and put it to humans. And so for humans, we now show that we can also take this very simple model, fit to predict, or to not predict, but describe muscle activation patterns in humans. Now, my humans are naive and they have never been on the platform, and my cats are on the platform for like a year, every day for a year, so they're really trained, overtrained. And so each individual has a slightly different pattern of muscle activity in response to this perturbation. That's the gray. However, in the red is our fit, just using three gains, and we kept the delay at 100 milliseconds because that's what we observe. And so we can parameterize these different responses just by varying the sensitivity to position, velocity, and acceleration error in these individuals. So that's a nice way of taking really complex sort of trajectories in time and reducing it down to a couple different numbers. Now, this is a tibialis anterior muscle. We also showed that you can use center of mass motion to fit other muscles that are more proximal. And then, I don't have my optimal here. I keep needing to put it back in. So none of these people look like the optimal solution, or some more than others, right? Because they've never done this before. The surprising thing is that we induced bigger perturbations that, instead of inducing sort of an ankle strategy in people, that caused them to do a hip strategy, in which case they don't really look like my inverted pendulum. And so we were trying to break the model and justify making a more complex biomechanical model. And it turns out I can just take the measured center of mass, acceleration, velocity, and position. I still reproduce the muscle activity. So this is when my thinking switched from the model being sort of a biomechanics model to a model being a neural control model of, like, the neural control system is monitoring this variable and generating muscle activity in response to not joint angles, but to center of mass kinematics. You can do other fun things with people, which we did sort of an adaptation paradigm. And you can see that if you give somebody the same forward perturbation 30 times, that their muscle activity actually decreases. But we can fit it again with our three parameters. So we're saying the sensitivity to position, velocity, acceleration is decreasing over multiple perturbations. This is tibialis anterior that's supposed to go on. This is the gastrocnemius, which is the antagonist. So you see some coactivation here, and then it disappears after about 30 trials. Well, it disappears a lot sooner, but it disappears over trials. And again, we can just characterize that as these three gains changing. Then we did a nasty trick where we had people, the perturbation would go forward, and at 100 milliseconds, we would reverse the direction. So that just as their tibialis anterior is being activated to stabilize them, we change the direction and make it destabilizing. So everybody does this first, and then over time they're able to handle this, but you can see that for the same acceleration here, the response is much smaller, right? So now they've adapted down their response to acceleration, and then their response looks much more like a sort of the optimal solution. We do a washout where now we go back to what we did up here for forward perturbation, and you can see now this person is coactivating the whole time, and the coactivation doesn't go away. That's because they don't trust me anymore. So they're like, what are you going to do next? I'm going to coactivate my muscles, right? So just in one person, I've shown you a huge amount of variation in how they can control their muscles depending on what they expect and, you know, whether they think this is a nasty experiment. And so this agonist-antagonist activity, we've been looking at it a lot. I'm not going to go over this, but suffice it to say, for a really long perturbation, I can also show this agonist-antagonist activity of TA and gastroc happening. And we are now looking at people with Parkinson's, showing that this coordination is impaired. So they tend to look like this, really coactivated. And then if we put them through adapted tango therapy, we think that goes away. All right. So for the roboticists and you, we also have done some work where we expanded this feedback model to look at interactions between the postural configuration, the mechanics of the body, so standing at a wide stance or a narrow stance, and how this delayed feedback has to change. So I'm not going to go over it a lot, but the idea is that I get really similar center of mass behaviors when I perturb somebody at a wide stance and a narrow stance, but I get really different muscle activity. And we showed in an analytical model that that was necessarily true, that if you stand with a wide stance, you must necessarily reduce your sensitivity to the perturbation, or you fall over like a tree, which is what people with Parkinson's do, and they also prefer to stand with a narrow stance. So we showed that narrow stance is more robust to high gains and to variability in those gains. And we came up with some neat math things to compare stability. And it's completely non-intuitive, and I even get it backwards when I talk about it. But if you want to see that, go to this paper right here, that paper. Okay. So for temporal muscle activity, what I've shown you is that there are many solutions, and we can actually characterize those inter-individual solutions that a lot of them we do predict based on just varying how much we care about biomechanics, controlling them well, how much we care about minimizing muscle activity. And so we see a difference in trained animals look really close to an optimum. College students don't. And if you put somebody in a situation of uncertainty, that you see a lot of coactivation to provide some local stability. Okay. And that many muscles are recruited by the same temporal signal, and that probably has to do with the multi-joint coordination, which I'll talk about next. And that, you know, we do see inter-individual differences, but they're not random and they're not willy-nilly. They're sort of very structured. They're just parameters within a similar structure across individuals. So when we look over time, it looks like a mess. But if we go back to the structure, then we can say something common across individuals. Okay, we're going to shift gears now to look at spatial motor structure, which is probably something that more of you have heard about our work, which is I get tired of talking about, but it's very interesting. So back to my motor modules. So we call them motor modules or muscle synergies. Started as muscle synergies. It gives people in the clinic the shivers because it means bad. So that's not what we're talking about. We're not talking about bad coordination. We're talking about structured coordination. And so we've sort of shifted to talking about them as motor modules, as a functional unit. But you'll see in here, my language goes back and forth because we're in this weird transition period of convincing people they should talk about it this way. So back to remember, this is my behavior, and now I'm going to be looking at the tuning curves, the spatial muscle activity, and we'll focus on a single time point just to look at what's happening. Okay, so what are these motor modules? We're going to take muscle tuning curves, so here's three muscles, for example, and we're looking at how, you know, are these controlled together? Are they not? Now here's three muscles with different muscle tuning curves. So you might conclude that they each need an independent controller. And we apply non-negative matrix factorization to try and see how independent these are. All right. And what we can do is back out actually a structure, a motor module, which is sort of the relative excitation level of the muscles, so high, low, and show that they can be, they're co-activated by a signal that is related to the function that's required, you know, when you perturb somebody around 100 or 200 degrees. So falling to the left, so you want to push to the right, for example. So the idea here is that when I need to push to the right, the amount that I need to push varies depending on the direction of my perturbation. And then what I'll do is say, oh, I need to push to the right. I'm going to activate muscle 1 a lot, muscle 2 not at all, and muscle 3 about halfway. And what that means is that these muscles will be strictly co-activated. Okay, but we don't actually see that on the output end, and that's because, well, these two muscles also have other functions that they can produce. And so when I go around that clock face, I will also have to push forward. And I might need to recruit those same two muscles to push forward, but maybe in different proportions. So around 180 degrees, I'll have to push forward. And so for 200, I need to push forward and push to the right. And so what happens here, if I want to push forward, I activate muscle 1 just a little bit, muscle 2 quite a bit, and muscle 3 about halfway. Okay, so that means that for pushing forward, these three muscles are all strictly co-activated to perform a task. But then when you have both functions concurrently activated, you add those two influences together, and you get the black lines that came back out. Okay, so this is a very nice idea. If you want to try this, it's not as straightforward and pretty as it looks, so call me. But we do have some tutorials online if you want to take a look, and if you also want to take a look at why I don't like principal components analysis. All right, so what did we find when we looked at the cats, because everything started with the cats, is that we could look at, these are muscles now, this is a level of activation, and we pulled out 4, sometimes 5 components. Which is great. What does it mean? So ultimately care about function. And what we showed is that you can correlate the activity of this motor module, right? So it coordinates lots of muscles, and this is sort of proximal to distal. So proximal and distal muscles are coordinated. And then the same muscles are recruited in lots of different functions. But so for this particular direction of perturbation, we could correlate the level of activity of these muscles to the value of the force direction, sort of the magnitude of the force in this particular direction. So we can decompose the forces as well. And so we can ascribe a particular function to each of these motor modules, where this one is responsible for pulling up, and this one for pushing forward, and this one for pushing backward. Okay, so that's really important, and other people have now shown that, well, you can sort of predict this organization based on biomechanics, again using energy optimization, at least in to the degree that we can compare a model to people and sort of squint at the structures and say they look about right. So what the other advantage of this is in just analyzing data, right? So here I have data. Now I've put this out as individual muscles, and I show in color, so black is how much they're activated across this clock face of perturbations, and the colors are the contributions of each motor module to the activity of that muscle. So you can see that, like, these two hamstring muscles are co-activated by the red motor module. This is a hamstring that's activated in both directions. We see that a lot with hamstrings, right there. They're bimodal. And you can see that for the 90 degree direction, it's activated pretty much by the red module in concert with these two hamstrings. But then in the 270 degree direction, it's activated with the blue module in concert with extensors, so gluteus and the vastus. So normally what you would do if you did like a correlation or a clustering or whatever, you would say this muscle is 50% correlated with this one and 50% correlated with that one. But you wouldn't be able to say anything more definitive than that of like, but here I can actually just say when it's active in 90 degrees, it's strictly correlated with here, these muscles, and when it's active over here, it's strictly correlated with the other muscles. And therefore I can parse out the two different functions that this muscle can contribute to. So it's useful to actually just see the structure of multiple muscle activation patterns using this technique. Okay. We see differences in the motor modules across individuals, whether they're cats or humans, whether they're highly trained cats or naive humans. And this is a simple example where I have three cats. There are different masses, and so we've now decomposed their motor modules and the associated force vectors they generate, right? So everybody has this red force vector, which is basically for standing, for weight bearing. And they're all active in the same directions, which suggests they're performing the same function more. Yes, question?
I was trying to understand why the difference between the 90 degree and the 270 degree directions, because they're just right and left, right? I would expect there to be some symmetry between the 90 and 270.
So this is just in one leg.
Okay.
So, yeah. So this is in the left hind limb. So there should be symmetry if I recorded in the other leg. But we usually devote all of our EMG recording resources to one leg. Sorry, I didn't say that. We're trying to do two legs, but then that's a lot of muscle. So so the red are the muscles that we recorded in common across these three animals, because we don't always have the same set of implanted electrodes. And you'll see that all of the animals in this, to produce this downward force, use their vastus medialis. So that's quadricep. That's just biomechanics. You need to have extensor muscles on to do weight bearing, right? So that's obligatory. But if you look at the hamstring muscles, which are here, so I have like, well, biarticular thigh muscles. I have sartorius, gracilis, biceps femoris, all that stuff. In this animal, you don't see very much activity. In this next animal, you see more activity of these muscles, and in the next animal, you see even more. So this is sort of coactivation that might not be predicted by sort of energy optimal methods. And the interesting thing is that we actually see these particular structures when we put the animal in different postural configurations. So it's not just biomechanics. We can put them in their feet close together and far apart, and each animal has a sort of signature of the way they like to activate their muscles that corresponds with a particular output. Okay, and there have been more recent. So we've done some modeling showing that not every pattern of muscle activation actually works across all of the biomechanical configurations, which suggests that this is reflecting neural control and not biomechanics. And there have been some recent papers showing that people like habitual solutions and not optimal ones. Even if you show them a better way to do it, they kind of revert back to their default, right? Now, we've shown the same thing in humans, and I'm not going to show you the big figure of all the differences in humans because I was told that was overwhelming. But in the humans, what we've done is we've been able to use the motor modules to look at trial by trial variability in people's responses. So again, remember, when you do adaptation, people sometimes they respond more, sometimes they respond less to the same type of perturbation. And that's reflected also in the spatial structure of the muscle activity. So for a given perturbation direction, sometimes you'll see a lot of this red motor module, sometimes not so much. And we can actually correlate those to different types of movement strategies. So how much ankle strategy you use or hip strategy you use is changing over different perturbations. But the nice thing is that we don't have to average our trials where we might be eliciting these two very different or mixes of different movement strategies, right? So if I had a bunch of perturbations where people started with the hip strategy and then they did an ankle strategy and then I averaged those EMGs together, I would get something that's not real. And so here we can explicitly say this part is ankle strategy, this part is hip strategy. So I generally don't like averaging either across trials or, and certainly not across subjects. And so we think that these trial by trial variations are real. They reflect differences in either the task or the adaptation of the individual. Okay, so they're not willy-nilly. The variation is not random. It's very structured across muscles. We did this in postural control, and now we've also shown that the modules, at least for a young, able-bodied individual, are very similar across the sort of reactive balance brainstem type of activity, as well as walking over ground, which we would presume has a different neural substrate. But we've done a bunch of papers where we looked at reactive stepping, people standing at wide stance, crouch stance, perturbations during walking, slow walking, fast walking. And the idea is that there are sets of motor modules that are common to those tasks, but they might be recruited differently at a higher level. So the modules are like the ultimate very, very low level kind of multi-joint control on which you can build higher level control. All right, so I'm seeing my time. And so again, our modules are constrained by but not uniquely determined by biomechanics, and we see different solutions, and that allows a sort of repetition without repetition where you can see variability from one trial to the next. And I would submit to you that there must be more motor modules than muscles. Even though we see a small number, we've really just tapped into a small set of behaviors. Okay, so the idea is that these sloptimal individual specific motor modules are maybe sort of giving us uniquely individual characteristics for how we move. So I have a few more minutes. I'll just go through that. What are the motor modules? They're definitely useful ways to interpret muscle activity. And there's more evidence that they do reflect a neural mechanism to control muscle activity. And I really like this quote from Heelings-Jackson, 1889. We have many chords. You can generate many different musical expressions out of a few notes. I'd say you can generate many different movements out of a few muscles. And there's some evidence that this reflects some of the structures in the muscle activity, in the nervous system. All right, so in 1 minute we'll go through some of the last things. That's not it. Some of you may have seen that we can use the motor modules in stroke and in spinal cord injury to look at characterize the differences in their muscle activity, and that's brought us to looking at gait patterns. So we have modules that modulate gait patterns. But what we're doing here is looking at changes in these patterns with stroke, and then with some rehabilitation in Parkinson's disease and in spinal cord injury with clinical collaborators, because that's not what I do. And I think that this is good. If you're meeting with me, you can ask me more about it. But I have some data showing differences in each of these populations, as well as with training by looking at a cohort of, ballet dancers and novices doing this beam task, which is what I showed you from the beginning. But I don't want to hold people here over time. We have an hour, right? Okay. And so I just want to put forth the idea that by understanding these principles, we can understand the effects of training and rehabilitation and trying to separate out individual differences in movements, as well as maybe whether the way somebody coordinates their muscles may predict their response to a therapy, to look at differences in how muscles are controlled, where you might produce a function through remediation or through compensation, and to ultimately sort of use these differences that we don't really see through functional tests to shape treatment for movement disorders. And so with that, I thank you for your attention, and I will thank my funding sources and collaborators, and then this is just if you want to ask me about robots, that we have that too. Thank you.
I was wondering that your deaffectated animal, it looked like you were able to model the activation of the muscle, but it looked like there was a lot of tonic activity that you weren't able to model. And I was wondering if, and sort of a wide gate thing, if you have like an alcoholic and cerebellar dysfunction, if you have this kind of tonic activation of, or if it's co-activation, tonic co-activation of muscles.
We didn't actually try to model that, but it's actually a very large focus right now because we see coactivity of muscles in many populations. As I showed you, one, we showed it in young individuals if we put them in particular contexts. So if there's uncertainty or fear, we know coactivity goes up. We also see it increased in Parkinson's disease and in some older adults, as well as in the stroke, people with stroke. So it's a very common sort of response, and it's a question of whether it is a compensation for loss of control, and then especially in Parkinson's disease, whether it's a primary sort of symptom of Parkinson's. So it's not clear what those two are, and with our modeling, we show that basically you add a little bit of coactivity and you increase the controllability of the system quite a bit. And so I think that there is a playoff going there. If I don't know what I'm supposed to do because I'm scared or it's uncertain, or if I have a compromised neural control system, then what I can do is hedge my bets by coactivating muscles, right? But there's a price to pay there. Because with a Parkinson's patient, if you coactivate their muscles, then you push them and they fall over like a tree, right? So that's the trade-off. So that's yeah.
Yeah, but in the deaffectated animal, do they coactivate to increase gain or to compensate for the loss of the effort? Do you think they are trying to?
I think it's a combination of both. I think they also stand with a slightly wider stance, and so that's why we were very interested in saying, well, how much stability do I gain by increasing my stance width, and how much do I gain by increasing my response, my sensitivity to the perturbation? And I was really interested in getting one number that could characterize that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Over here.
So your observations are primarily you imposing a perturbation on the subject. Is the response going to be qualitatively different when the subject imposes a perturbation on their own walking, if they're trying to turn, if they're trying to get around something? If instead of walking on that beam, if they had to turn to get around an obstacle or something like that, where they're involved with the perturbation, but they still have to maintain balance, is it going to be masking that, or is it going to be qualitative?
I don't know the answer to that. We have now data from people with Parkinson's that we're trying to analyze, where they're doing figure eights and things like that. We do have one paper where we were perturbing people while they're walking over the platform, right? So they were going and you know, they're expecting it, that it's not getting perturbed all the time, but if they're expecting a perturbation, we do see a slight coactivation of muscles that we don't see sort of at the beginning of the experiment where like we just walk across the room, right? So my guess is that it would depend on the ability of the patient and how confident they were in their balance ability in negotiating a turn.
But if you had the beam was coming up to across, say, and when it gets to that across, if you told them when a green light goes on, you have to turn to the right or you have to turn to the left, then it has to change. That person has to change it by itself. It's making a decision to change it, but it still has to maintain stability while it's...
Right, right. So I think that it will depend on who that, like the dancers might not do it, and the people with Parkinson's might be doing that. Although they're sort of coactive all the time, so it's hard to dissociate. I had a question here.
Yes. When you said that the vastus medialis is a weight-bearing muscle, would it really become more or less active, when the posture is being perfectly erect when it is not, and therefore it's more of a suspensatory compensation muscle rather than a weight-bearing muscle?
Well, you need knee extension, right? I mean, let's assume that the knees aren't completely locked out, right? So, and then you still have moment arm to generate extensor torque, the patella, and in fact, but the example that I had was cats, so they're actually crouched, so they do actually need their vastus medialis.
Just to keep them erect. Yes.
Yeah, so they have to have these active. They're actually more like this, so there's even more quadriceps activity.
Another question I want to ask is about the number of modules that you require when you are doing the synergy mm-hmm. study. Mm-hmm. If you reduce the number of modules, that is, you want to say that the central nervous system is controlling the muscles with a fewer number of modules than the number of muscles that you have. But wouldn't that lead to a non-unique solution to the problem? I mean, the number of muscles.
So there are, yes, so I agree that there are, for any given task, right, I'm coordinating multiple muscles, and so I'm going to have necessarily fewer modules active to produce that task. And our modeling shows that, yes, those are non-unique solutions, and that's why we see differences across individuals. When I look at a larger repertoire of actions, I'm expecting to see more modules than muscles. So now if I want to go sideways or dancing or that kind of thing. But I think that for a particular task, for a particular action, there are a few biomechanical tasks that I need to coordinate. And I'm going to draw upon those sort of libraries, put them together, assemble them to do that. Then want to go play, you know, something else, do something else with my leg, then I may draw upon a different set of coordination. So that's been shown that when you do side cuts and that kind of a thing, the coordination patterns in the limb are more varied. But again, not the same for everybody. I think here.
These motor synergies that we're not supposed to, what were we supposed to call
them? Modules.
Modules. If I'm learning a new task, so you said they're evolved and innate and learned also. Am I as a, you know, a mature, pretty static motor control system, if I'm learning a brand new task, am I developing new modules or am I taking existing modules and applying new control strategies?
So in our ballet dancers, we showed that when they walk across the beam and over ground, they're actually using very similar modules, but the novices are using, so they're like exploring, basically because they're falling. And this is actually when they're not falling, just when they're walking. So it looks like they're using some of the same modules, but ultimately when you get experience, it looks like learning a more challenging task might refine existing modules, and then what it will do is expands the range of tasks that you can perform with that set of modules. But what it necessarily does also here is it changes how you perform that nominal task. So as I perform this more skilled task and I can expand what I can do with those modules, it will also affect the way in which I walk when I don't necessarily have those challenges. So the point at which you now develop a new module, I don't know. Clearly those tasks that ballet dancers can do that, you know, we can't do. We purposely actually tested them in tasks that they did not train in to try and look at the influences of this training on performance of everyday tasks. And I think that's relevant to rehabilitation because you have people doing things in the clinic, they're practicing things, but you really want them to walk across the street by themselves, right? And you're not training that. So you want to make sure that what you do actually transfers over. Paulo?
In your perturbation task, you show that as people, when you as people did the task more, they still maintained the same 100 millisecond latency, but they had an anticipation strategy where they could activate, right? But you know, let's say you take a normal person like a ballet dancer or a ninja or somebody, my son takes cycle or something like that.
Yeah.
But they don't walk around, you know, ninjas don't walk around co-activated all the time.
Right.
So I'm wondering, is there a difference in the latency potentially as opposed to the co-activation strategy? Because that would seem like somebody who has a faster reaction time, I would expect like a shorter latency.
So,
right,
the 100 millisecond or maybe 80 to 100 millisecond seems to be a hard boundary on how fast it takes for the processing. There have been a number of studies, and we basically can't advance it any more than that. You can delay it, and it will get delayed in different impairments, but it doesn't ever really get faster. We've gotten it to go faster by about 10 milliseconds, but that's not really a big deal, right? We do have data from the ballet dancers now on the reactive balance that we are starting to look at. The other thing is during the adaptation, we do see a little bit more co-activation during quiet standing. And so they could do that, and it may be that the ballet dancers don't do that as much. So an idea is that if you're a ballet dancer and you're very confident in your neural control, then you don't need to do the co-activation, right? So they just kind of, they can handle it and they rely on their reactive responses. I have a question.
One last question. Tango seems to be very challenging even for normal people. So what do you guys think Tango for Parkinson's?
So Madeline Hackney designed this with Gammon Earhart, and then we just sort of tacked on our studies. But the adapted Tango is really good because there's no prescribed form of steps. So from any position, you can actually do all of the different directions. So it's the most diverse. Whereas, you know, if the waltz, you step backwards and you always step to the left. So you don't want to train people to do that. The other is it's partnered, and we use a practice stance. And so people are holding on to, so it's safe, right? And then the other is that there's a bunch of dual tasking that you have to do because they have to learn a step, not look at their feet, navigate with a partner. All of the patients, they will lead, they'll follow, and then they'll also lead. So there's equal parts leading and following, and the idea is that they're better at externally cued movements, and then you also challenge them to do internally generated movements, which people with Parkinson's have difficulty doing. And so Madeline's already shown that like balance and gait clinical scores improve after participation in Tango. So like I think Berg balance test and DGI improve. But I think it's for a number of reasons. We're now looking at like cognitive tests, whether they improve, things like that. Plus people, not over 90% adherence, plus they want to do more because it's fun and there's social interaction.
So lastly, we have a photo book of Lena.
Great.
To remember your visit.
Thank you.
Thank you again.
Thank you very much. Thank you.